She wanna ride the boat. Baby, take control. What to do, YouTube? It's your boy T Lee, and I'm back with another crazy reaction to a crazy video. Now, this one is top 10 musicians who were in their careers with just one album. Just one. I gotta see what this is talking about. With just one album? God damn. Let's get it. 3, 2, 1.
They can't all be winners. Welcome to Watch Mojo, and today we're counting down our picks for the top 10 musicians who ruined their careers with one album. For this list, we'll be ranking the artists or bands who released a flop that, whether due to drastic stylistic changes, personnel shifts, or other reasons, did massive damage to their reputations. Even if some of these albums also have their defenders, the acts can since have bounced back, but we're at a minimum.
Let's see what they're talking about. Must have been really trash. Damn.
Muse, Sick and Our Message. Sometimes all it takes is a bad review, or several in the case of our first entry. Public Enemy's Muse, Sick and Our Message. Savage critiques from both Rolling Stone and The Source hampered the pre-release buzz of this fifth album from some of hip-hop's preeminent elder statesmen, resulting in severe sales drops and fan backlash. The sentiment at the time was that Public Enemy seemed to be out of touch with the musical world they helped pioneer, as some of the rhymes attacked the then-popular genre of gangster rap. To be fair, not all of the reviews were bad, and Muse, Sick and Our Message is well-regarded by some fans of the group today. But yeah, Fear of a Black Planet, this album was not.
Looking back on it, when we were making Fear of a Black Planet, hell yeah, we knew we were making something that wasn't done. Back then, we definitely knew what was not being done.
Number 9, Madonna, American Life.
Die-hard fans lining up for days, hoping to get a chance to see a rare performance.
There's one surefire way to ruin Madonna. A musical career, and it's distancing yourself from what made you.
Thought she's supposed to be in a go.
This is a theme we're going to be revisiting a number of times here on our list, starting with Madonna's infamous 2003 album, American Life.
Being a rebel, being androgynous, 1, 2, 3. You know, doing all these kind of things, trying to be number one on the top.
The album is heavily removed, sonically and conceptually disconnected, from the polished pop sound that drove Madonna madness in the 80s and 90s. Although her previous albums, Music and Ray of Light, both featured experiments that were musically different from her past, the Madonna who raps on American Life didn't sound like the material girl or the provocateur found on Erotica. She sounded out of touch.
I agree with you in theory.
Did she go out with Tupac, y'all? Comment below if I was right. Didn't Tupac clap them cheeks? Who's Jewel?
We're continuing on this subject of drastic stylistic shifts with our next entry, Jewel's notorious dud 0304. Although it must be noted that the album was Jewel's highest charting effort when it was initially released, going gold within a month, the album's sales figures didn't stay there long. This was due to the album's
Jewel's polish.
As evidenced by Jewel's
She wasn't so polished.
Of a sellout cash-in culture, but fans didn't buy it, especially after the song was licensed to a Schick razor commercial. In the end, 0304's dance floor sound helped shatter much of the good.
No wonder. No wonder.
Starting in January of 2021, the first artist on the sign
is me, T. Lee.
Never mind.
Won't be signing nothing, guys.
What do you do years after creating one of the most acclaimed debuts of all time? You reach for the pop world's brass ring, of course. That's what indie rocker Liz Phair tried to do with her self-titled fourth album. Phair's Exile in Guyville debut was an underground hit, thanks to its catchiness and professional, authentic lyrics. But then Phair was convinced by her record company to work with pop songwriting team The Matrix. This collaboration resulted in a sound that was much more pop.
Isn't Neo? Damn, she did his. She did a song with Neo?
Although the album was defended by prominent critic Robert Christgau, Pitchfork gave it a 0 out of 10. While the New York Times' Megan O'Rourke even called the album
one last time we listened to Neo.
Ouch. Number 6, Lauryn Hill. There's something about the unplugged setting that exposes everything about an artist's music, from its innermost genius to its most severe flaws. Lauryn Hill found the latter out firsthand when she brought a collection of unfinished and unfocused new material to the recording of her MTV Unplugged number 2.0 session.
I told the people at MTV they gotta like me better, if not people will keep saying, who's that boy?
Hill had been writing riding high from solo album success, not to mention her work with the Fugees. But personal issues began to affect her creative side at the time in a big way. Hill's voice here is almost completely shot, and her acoustic guitar skills seemingly non-existent. As she clumsily strums along to the songs, she often has to start multiple times due to her lack of focus. It's the worst kind of musical train wreck from an artist who honestly deserved better. Number 5. The Clash. Sure. Cut the Crap.
The Clash.
Sometimes a band has a clear leader, while other times it's really more about the sum of its parts.
All we can try to communicate is, number one, you've been brainwashed since the day you were born. Number two, you've got to do a lot of work to even do any of your own thinking.
The Clash's Joe's drummer thought he could soldier on after firing co-founder Mick Jones and drummer Topper Heaton. But bad management decisions and a desire to latch on to 1980s trends of the day eventually led to disaster. Cut the Crap almost never enters into any fan discussion about The Clash, and with good reason, as the album is more the brainchild of manager-producer Bernie Rhodes than any sort of cohesive post-punk statement. Dissonant production, harsh synthesizer sounds, and ham-fisted drum machine programming derail any decent song idea Strummer had for Cut the Crap, which effectively ended the band.
That's a good point. I agree with him, by the way, yeah.
Number 4. Oasis, Be Here Now. The adversarial relationship of the Gallagher brothers is inescapable common knowledge at this point, but there's generally something to be said about keeping it together for the sake of mutual success, or not. Sadly, the tensions between Noel and Liam really came to a head during the recording sessions for Be Here Now. The album is bloated and self-indulgent, the sound of a bickering group laden with bad drug problems and a lack of strong ideas at the height of their broad success.
It's your best album. Okay. I don't think it is. No, you're wrong. That's just an opinion. How can an opinion be wrong? Yeah, well, yours is.
While the psychedelic Britpop vibe present on their greatest hits is still there on Be Here Now, the lack of restrained arrangements, smart lyrics, or engaging vocals resulted in the album being relegated largely to the used bit.
You need help. Let God help you through this.
Number 3. Styx. Kilroy was here.
I see a future without rock and roll music.
Whoa.
As I speak to you now, young people all over this country are burning guitars and records.
What do you think of when you imagine a massive early 80s outdoor rock concert? Screaming fans, loud guitars, and a short film presentation?
I'm Attorney Charles Kilroy. You have persistently and flagrantly violated Code 672, which forbids the playing and purveying of rock music.
Needless to say, this did not go over well when Styx brought their overblown rock opera, Kilroy Was Here, to outdoor arenas after initially debuting it in small venues. The album was the last Styx album to go platinum and the final hurrah for the lineup that first won over arena rock fans with songs like Renegade and Blue Collar Man.
You can't stop the music, you bastard!
I thought the same thing.
These same working class fans didn't exactly appreciate the over-reliance on keyboards and balladry with Kilroy, however, nor the accompanying movie that aired on screens throughout the tour. Sure, the album did bring Mr. Roboto to the masses, but is that really a good thing? Number 2. Van Halen. Van Halen 3. Van Halen were on their third singer when they recorded Van Halen 3, replacing Sammy Hagar with former Extreme frontman Gary Cherone. This isn't actually a bad choice on paper, as Cherone is a fine vocalist, but the resulting album did little to showcase that fact. The songwriting ranged from puzzling to simply painful, with tunes that were needlessly long, and it showcased little of the fire that categorized Van Halen's early days. Meanwhile, the decision to have Eddie Van Halen himself sing an awkward piano ballad couldn't have been made by anyone with a working pair of ears. The band didn't return with a new album for almost 15 years.
Damn.
And when they did, it was with founding frontman David Lee Roth back in the saddle. Before we unveil our number one pick, here are some honorable, or should we say dishonorable, mentions.
Billy Idol.
Before we continue, be sure to subscribe to our channel and ring the bell to get notified about our latest videos. You'll have the option to be notified for occasional videos or all of them. If you're on your phone, make sure you go into your settings and switch on notifications. Number 1. Robin Thicke.
Damn.
Not every confessional album is a home run. Case in point, the disaster.
Get her back, yeah, man.
Yeah, he definitely simped off of that shit. How you go from blurry lines to that shit?
But to market that attempt for commercial gain as some sort of concept album. Although the record's attempts at neo soul are strong at times, Thick's personal bad boy behavior in the tabloids had largely killed any goodwill for the artist prior to its release. And this isn't even mentioning the similar controversy that emerged with the sexual politics behind his hit Blurred Lines. Paula became even more notable for its disastrous sale figures in countries like Australia, Canada, and the UK, with some numbers totaling less than 200 units during its first week. Yikes. Do you agree with our picks? Check out this other recent...
All right, that'll be it. Like and subscribe on the road to 100K subscribers.
Comment if you feel like all these people deserve to be there. Because I did.
Comment, man. I honestly agree, man. But we out here. Let's go.
Press start, I pass the moon. To the stars, I see you soon. Yeah, yeah. Took a tap, now I'm going on a cruise.